Good morning and welcome to our Sunday morning service. This is another occasion when we can't meet together and see each other in a church setting, but as a church we can meet together. And you might also like to tune in to Breakfast at 9, which is premiered at 9 o'clock on a Sunday morning, which is before this service. Tune in, see what you think, and let us know. Can I read you something that Moses said? I will proclaim the name of the Lord. Oh, praise the greatness of our God. He is the rock. His works are perfect and all his ways are just. A faithful God who does no wrong, upright and just is he. And as Moses comes to the end of his life, he reflects on the way that God has guided his people through his life and seen all the incredible things that he's done. He is their rock. And God is our rock. He is stable. He is dependable. And he's always the same. He's reliable. He's not like us that go up and down. We can trust in his unwavering faithfulness. And he will be with us wherever we are. Let me just pray. Father, we thank you that you are with us wherever we are. We thank you that you are the rock on which we can trust. We thank you for allowing us to be together this morning and be with us, we pray. Amen. My hope is built on nothing less is the song that we're going to sing shortly. Well, you might want to listen to it or clap your hands. You can do what you like in the comfort of your own home, can't you? But the writer of that hymn talks about how Jesus Christ is the rock and he stands firm. Living is quite hard at the moment for many people, and different people may have experienced a number of perhaps dark times and hard times, but they can be reassured and we can be reassured this morning that whatever comes our way, he is still the rock.
I dare not trust the sweetest frame, but wholly lean on Jesus' name. On Christ the solid rock I stand, all other ground is sinking sand, all other ground is sinking sand. Seems to hide his face, I rest on his unchanging grace. In every high and stormy gale, my anchor holds within the veil. On Christ the solid rock I stand, all other ground is sinking sand. All of the ground is sinking sand.
Good morning, Freshbrook.
Good morning. It's our privilege to pray with you this morning.
We were thinking of the song Waymaker, Miracle Worker, Light in the Darkness. My God, that is who you are. You are here, working in this place, touching and healing every heart, turning lives around. We worship you. Let's pray. Our Heavenly Father, we worship you. We honour you, we exalt your name, we bless you, Lord God Almighty, and we now want to appreciate you in all your beauty, your power and your love. And as we listen to John, our pastor, we want you to touch us by the power of your Holy Spirit in our innermost being. Change our thought patterns, remove anything in our lives which prevents us from being free to know you, to experience being loved by you, and prevents us from serving you in power.
Isaiah said, "Wisdom and knowledge of God shall be the stability of your times." Father, would you help us to focus on your word, to stand on your promises, and to walk by faith and trust in you, and not by our emotions at this time. When fear comes, please remind us to keep our minds on you in total trust and so live in perfect peace. Thank you that you promise never to leave us. So we pray for those who live in isolation and alone, that they will have an absolute assurance of your presence with them.
And in the mighty name of Jesus, we bind any enemy action through virus, sickness, defeat, depression, lack, in the lives of our church family and in our community, and in fact nationwide and worldwide. We pray that you will turn the tables on what the enemy has meant for evil, bringing many, many souls into your kingdom as a result of this present suffering in our nation and beyond. We pray for those in our community who are beginning to fear the future. We pray that they'll be drawn to seek you. We pray their eyes will be open to see your love, your kindness and justice, that you would send Christians across their path who are willing to speak about you and lead them to Jesus. Would you give us the creativity as a church to know how to effectively reach our neighbours? Would you set up divine appointments and make us bold to speak for you and to radiate the love of Jesus? Would you give clear guidance to our leaders as to how to move forward with a church vision as to see lives changed in this area of Freshbrook?
We want to thank you for modern technology. We have the possibility as never before of communicating and meeting together. We thank you for your word being broadcast to virtually every nation by television and internet. We know your word will not return to you void, but will be successful in the purpose for which you sent it. We continue to remember our families worldwide suffering for the sake of the good news of Jesus, unable to meet openly or even virtually as we are doing. We pray that even in desperation and in the face of huge adversity, their faith will not fail. We pray for the poorest in the world who are in lockdown too, many devastated, even to the point of near starvation. Migrant workers, daily labourers, slum dwellers, all unable to work and therefore without food this time, in countries failing to make provision for them. We pray you will move us to respond to needs wherever we can.
And in our country, we are so grateful for the privileges, financial benefits, a compassionate healthcare system, and for the devotion of key workers. Will you always remind us, Lord, to be so grateful and never to take this for granted? And so, Father, as we are blessed, we want to be willing to be a blessing this week, to be at the right place at the right time and ready to represent you faithfully. We thank you for the plans that you have for each of us. May we be willing and obedient to follow in your footsteps without deviating, learning more of you and enjoying your grace, your mercy, your extravagant love for us, your protection and shalom peace. May we recognize that as we love you and are called to your purpose, you will work out all things, good, bad and indifferent, for our good.
Father, we know we can approach you boldly and without fear, only because of the high price Jesus paid to make a way to you. We stand amazed, yet so thankful for all he has done on our behalf. The price is paid in full. The battle is fully won. So we come to you with our thanks and requests in the name of Jesus, our Lord and Saviour.
Amen. Amen.
The reading is from Genesis chapter 12, verse 6 to chapter 13, verse 4. Abram travelled through the land as far as the site of the great tree of Moreh at Shechem. At that time the Canaanites were in the land. The Lord appeared to Abram and said, "To your offspring I will give this land." So he built an altar there to the Lord who had appeared to him. From there he went on towards the hills east of Bethel and pitched his tent, with Bethel on the west and Ai on the east. There he built an altar to the Lord and called on the name of the Lord. Then Abram set out and continued towards the Negev. Now there was a famine in the land, and Abram went down to Egypt to live there for a while, because the famine was severe. As he was about to enter Egypt, he said to his wife Sarai, "I know what a beautiful woman you are. When the Egyptians see you, they will say, 'This is his wife.' Then they will kill me, but will let you live. Say you are my sister, so that I will be treated well for your sake, and my life will be spared because of you." When Abram came to Egypt, the Egyptians saw that she was a very beautiful woman. And when Pharaoh's officials saw her, they praised her to Pharaoh, and she was taken into his palace. He treated Abram well for her sake, and Abram acquired sheep and cattle, male and female donkeys, men servants and maid servants, and camels. But the Lord inflicted serious diseases on Pharaoh and his household because of Abram's wife Sarai. So Pharaoh summoned Abram. "What have you done to me?" he said. "Why didn't you tell me she was your wife? Why did you say she is my sister, so that I took her to be my wife? Now then, here is your wife. Take her and go." Then Pharaoh gave orders about Abram to his men, and they sent him on his way with his wife and everything he had. So Abram went up from Egypt to the Negev with his wife and everything he had, and Lot went with him. Abram had become very wealthy in livestock and in silver and gold. From the Negev he went from place to place until he came to Bethel, to the place between Bethel and Ai, where his tent had been earlier, and where he had first built an altar. There Abram called on the name of the Lord.
It's easy sometimes to sing the words of hymns, and it's more difficult to put it into practice. we often create a barrier between us and God, or perhaps make walls between us and God. I'm thinking about walls. I wonder how many famous walls you know in the world that were built perhaps to keep people in or out. Now, if I was very clever at this point, there would be a picture depicting these walls or on the laser display board behind me, but we'd have to stick this morning to just doing some clues. So let me give you some clues and see how good you are. If I said the borders of Scotland, what wall would be there? Brilliant, yes, Hadrian's Wall. Lots of you got that. China. Yes, I can hear you saying the Great Wall of China as well. That's good. Jerusalem. Yeah, a few different answers, but the same, actually, it's the Western Wall. There are other ones as well, of course, as you know. But if I said Berlin, yeah, the Berlin Wall, that's one that was the most well-known when someone was doing a similar sort of quiz. And I think it was just before Christmas, we were remembering the 30 years when the walls were torn down. That wall was a particularly nasty wall because it wasn't just one wall, it was two walls measuring 155 kilometres and 4 metres high, and in the middle there was a corridor that was called the Death Strip because it was mined. And in fact, when people were crossing from East Germany to West Germany, a lot of people died as a result of that. And as a much younger person, I can remember people coming into our church and talking about how they had taken Bibles or literature or just been to visit Christians in the East and going through the checkpoints. Some of the miracles that had happened where God allowed these Bibles to go through. Now, if you haven't read some of those stories, I urge you to perhaps seek those out. But the wall coming down in Berlin was amazing because so many people thought that was impenetrable. Perhaps I can ask you another question. Who was it that fought the Battle of Jericho and that involved walls coming down? Yeah, you're on the ball this morning. Yes, it is Joshua. And I really like this story for a number of reasons, because Joshua felt unqualified for the task of taking over from Moses. But God promised him that he would be with him all every step of the way. And I guess it's Joshua's strict obedience to God that is crucial in this particular story. At every turn, Joshua did exactly what God had suggested he did, and the Israelites were victorious. You remember the story. God had given a rather unusual strategy for the Battle of Jericho. He told Joshua and his men to march round six times. Some people were playing trumpets. The Ark of the Covenant was there. I wonder what people thought when they looked out and saw this army walking round the city wall. And then what happened? Well, we know the story. The next day when they went round again, the walls, in the words of the old chorus, came tumbling down. Joshua's strong faith in God led him to obey no matter how illogical his God's commands seemed to Joshua. And he, Joshua, remembered the past and knew how that God had carried out what seemed impossible things when Moses was leading the people. Faith and obedience, courage and patience had to be practiced, gaining victory over Jericho. Do we ever build walls in and around ourselves? You might say, well, actually, we're fed up of the four walls that we're living in just at the moment. But that apart, our lives sometimes do have walls, and we build walls too. Perhaps to protect us from other people or from ourselves. and outsiders. Some of these walls are subtle and we don't always realise they're there, but sometimes we might throw them up intentionally and we almost relish the fact that they're there. And at the moment there may be a wall of fear perhaps, especially in these uncertain times. But I think if this story of Joshua has anything to tell us, we need to choose faith and not fear, because we need to remember that God is our rock. In Hebrews we read it was by faith that the Jericho walls fell down, but it was the Lord who commanded it to happen. And this morning, like lots of other times, it's good to know that God is stronger than any walls, both physically and metaphorically, that we've built. And he's stronger than any problem that exists. Let's listen or sing along to the next hymn, which is Ancient of Days. We've sung it before in church, one or two times, but it's good to refresh our memories on that. There's some really good words within that hymn.
Thank you so much for joining us again, Freshbrook Church Online. It's a real joy to be able to share these morning worship services together and to look at God's Word and see what it teaches us today. You've joined us for the second of our talks in the life of Abraham. We've been looking at an ancient story that comes to life as we look at it today. Abraham, described in the Bible as the father of all those who have faith. Every Christian is called a child of Abraham. And we looked last time at how God called this man from being a moon god worshipping pagan in the land of Ur of the Chaldees, down in southern Iraq it would be today. and called him to leave his old way of life and to follow after God. And so we ended last week with Abraham setting out on this new adventure of faith, walking with God. So our theme is being a hero of faith. Now, if you've ever read any biographies or stories of Christians in the past, a lot of them are sometimes quite difficult to read because you get the impression that these people never did anything wrong. They were like superheroes, and you're just waiting them to put their pants on outside their trousers and just fly across the room because they are so amazing. And it can be really discouraging. No doubts, no bad choices, no kicking of the cat. And it can make you feel, well, there's no hope for me. I can't be like them. Thankfully, the Bible tells its stories quite differently. Our heroes of the faith are shown to be people with feet of clay who make mistakes, who get it badly wrong at times, who sometimes do things that are quite shocking. And still we find that God loves them and calls them to walk with him. And that's what we're going to see about our hero Abraham today as we look at a story that I've called When Faith Fails. You'll find that story in Genesis chapter 12, verse 6 through to chapter 13, verse 4. And the first thing that we're going to look at as the story unfolds for us is Abraham walking by faith. And that's in chapter 12, verses 6 to 9. Abraham traveled through the land as far as the site of the great tree of Moreh at Shechem. At that time, the Canaanites were in the land. The Lord appeared to Abraham and said, "To your offspring I will give this land." So he built an altar there to the Lord who had appeared to him. From there, he went on towards the hill east of Bethel and pitched his tent with Bethel on the west and Ai on the east. There he built an altar to the Lord and called on the name of the Lord. Then Abraham set out and continued towards the Negev. Now the Negev is down in the south of Israel, as you'll know if you've ever been on one of these amazing holidays down to the south of Israel. But what is our hero up to? Bethel, Moreh, Negev. This looks more like a road trip than a journey of faith. But there are clues in the way the story is told to us, and the clues come in verse 7 and verse 8, where we're told, "There he built an altar. There he built an altar." You get a sense of what our hero is doing. God has called him from his own place of Ur. He's traveled to the land of promise, the land of Israel. And now he is wandering around the land, and wherever he goes, he sets up these altars. It's like he's claiming every inch of land for the God who he has come to know. He's simply getting on with what God has told him to do. And that's the life of faith. This morning, a simple lesson as we begin looking at this passage. God calls us, if we are following the Lord Jesus Christ, to a simple life of faith. Now, that doesn't mean wandering around Freshbrook or Grange Park or even up onto the top of Toot Hill or wherever you live and building altars like brick barbecues. What it means is simply following the Lord Jesus, and he calls us to a life where we love him and we love the people around us. The call is a simple one. There may be many adventures to come, and undoubtedly there will be, because there are tremendous adventures along the Christian path. But everything begins in this place, simply walking by faith, loving him, loving people. Every day, loving Jesus, reading his word, praying to him, worshipping him, repenting of our sins and finding forgiveness. And every day, loving those around us in random acts of kindness and words of hope spoken in the name of Jesus. Symbols. That's how we set up our altars. It's not very flashy, is it? It sounds very ordinary. But this is the life of faith. God is looking for heroes. Heroes who will wander around the land setting up altars. Remember, that's picture language. Ordinary people like you and me who will love Jesus and live for Jesus by loving the people around us. On your own, with your friends, with your family, love Jesus, love the people around you. I wonder if you're willing in your heart and with your life to commit to that today. I'm going to stop for a moment and lead us in a prayer as we respond to Abraham's example. Lord, in this moment, we hear you call us to live a simple life of faith. And we pray that you'd help us to give ourselves to you completely, to love you day by day, to read your word, to worship, to pray, to repent, to walk with you, and then to love this world around us in acts of kindness and words of hope. Lord, for some of us, that's just going to mean staying out of people's way and socially distancing and just having that sense of love for others. But some of us, you'll call to go and deliver things, medicines to people's doors, food to those who are isolated and alone. For some of us, it will mean picking up the phone and phoning a lonely person, or joining a Zoom prayer meeting where maybe we just felt like escaping. We'll love others. Help us to do that. And whatever you call us to, help us to give ourselves, we pray. We commit ourselves to you, Holy Spirit. Come and seal that commitment. And in the days ahead, roll out what it looks like for us to walk with Jesus in simple faith. Amen. So secondly, look with me at faith on trial. Verse 10, now there was a famine in the land, and Abraham went down to Egypt to live there for a while because the famine was severe. So here is Abraham, and he's getting on with the life of faith. And as he does so, he faces a massive trial. Now, southern Israel, where he was in the Negev, is prone to famine, and our hero is hit by a big one. The Bible tells us that God allows severe trials to come to his children as they walk with him by faith. Financial trials, money shortages, work problems, problems in our families, stresses and strains, health problems, all kinds of illness, physical and mental, and national problems like the one we're facing at the moment with the COVID crisis. We will face all these trials, and they don't mean that we have suddenly stepped outside of the will of God, or that God is angry with us, or God is judging us. You may have come across stuff saying that when trials come, it must be because we've done something wrong. I'm reminded of that song in, in The Sound of Music, where they sing, or Mary Poppins, well, I forget from my childhood now, I must have done something good when all kinds of good things come to me. And it's pagan superstition. The Bible doesn't work like that. We don't get good things when we do good things and get bad things when we do bad things. The Bible teaches us that this whole idea of karma is just wrong. If you're facing trial and difficulty, it doesn't mean that you're on plan B, that you've stepped out of God's will, or that he's displeased with you. Here is Abraham, our hero. And he is, at this point in the story, walking by faith, just getting on with what God told him to do. And he faces this tremendous trial. He is in the will of God, and he is facing the trial. So if today you are facing trials in your life of any kind, and you've been tempted to despair and think, what have I done? What have I done? God must be so angry with me. Please let the Bible blow that thought away and come to the God who is with you in the trials, just as he was with Abraham. The challenge is, how do we respond to the trials that come to us as we walk by faith? See, Abraham could have been tempted to go back to Haran or back to Ur, neither of which were in famine. They were in much more prosperous areas, but he didn't go back. That was a good choice. For the believer, there is no turning back. And if your life is hard at the moment and you're thinking of giving up and going back to the old way of life, that is never the right choice to make. So let's just stop for a moment. Maybe right now you feel that what is happening to you is a mark of God's displeasure, or that you must have done something bad. And you may be tempted to give up and go back, to give up walking with Jesus. Don't go back. This is not God's displeasure. Trials come. Hold on, he is still with you. Remember Abraham, walking with God, setting up the altars, but hit by tremendous famine. Let's just be still for a moment. Lord, we bring to you those amongst us, virtually watching us on this video, who perhaps are feeling a sense of being failures or having done something wrong because there's a trial in their family or in their personal lives, or they feel the weight of the COVID crisis and they hear the voices saying, oh, you must have done something wrong. Will you please help them this morning to be reassured that you can walk with God and be in God's will and still face trials? Let them know that you are with them. Help them to make good choices in the trial. We pray for ourselves. Lord, help us to respond in the right way to the trials that we face. Come, Holy Spirit, and help us, we pray, for we are weak, but you are strong. In Jesus' name, amen. The faith doesn't always hold strong. And we're going to look thirdly at when faith fails. Genesis 12, verses 11 to 13. When we get into Egypt, say, you are my sister, so that I will be treated well for your sake and my life will be spared because of you. So I'm reading verse 13, aren't I? Let's go back to verse 11. This is just like live preaching. As he was about to enter Egypt, he said to his wife Sarah, I know what a beautiful woman you are. When the Egyptians see you, they will say, this is his wife, and then they'll kill me, but will let you live. So say you are my sister, so that I will be treated well for your sake, and my life will be spared because of you. This is a fascinating moment in the story, and it shows us a lot about how our thinking can undo us. Walking by faith means listening to God, trusting him, and doing what he says. Here Abraham follows his inner voice rather than God's outer voice, and it leads him into trouble. You see how his thinking undoes him. Verse 11. As he was about to enter Egypt, he said to his wife, I know what a beautiful woman you are. Well, that's a good start, Abraham. That's a great thing to say. When the Egyptians see you, they will say, this is his wife, and then they'll kill me, but they'll let you live. Say you're my sister, so that I'll be treated well for your sake, and my life will be spared because of you. Abraham thinks he knows what will happen. He assumes the worst, and he writes that story in his head. Now, there are lots of stories he could have written, lots of scripts he could have written. He could have assumed, for example, that Pharaoh would be an honourable man. He could have trusted that God would protect him and Sarah because God had said, I will be with you, come and follow me. But no, he believes the story that he's written in his head and he follows it through. No asking God, no remembering the promises, no thinking of the actual consequences of his actions. He just goes through and follows his own thoughts. Now, we need to learn to stop and challenge the thoughts that we have. We tend to assume that our thoughts are always correct. They seem so real to us, but often they're not. They are just thoughts. We need to stop them, challenge them, and assess them. What does God say? What does God's word say? What has God promised us? Now, to be honest, this story makes shocking and shameful reading. Abraham's disregard for his wife Sarah is disgraceful. There's no way of hiding this. This is the Bible showing its hero, warts and all. There's no concern for his wife's dignity. He starts well, doesn't he? You're really beautiful, Sarah. But it's like, that's just a sham. That's just flannel. The reality is he doesn't care about her. Not at this point in the story. All he cares about is himself and keeping himself safe. He doesn't think about her dignity. He doesn't think about her safety. He doesn't think about her feelings. He's controlled by the script he's written in his head. He just wants to self-protect. Now, does it surprise you that our hero of faith, Abraham, behaves like this? Did you perhaps expect better of a hero of faith? Well, don't be surprised, and don't necessarily expect better. You and I are capable of just the same sort of things. This story is here to warn us and to encourage us. If we've really messed up, we can still be heroes of faith, because Abraham's story doesn't end here. But let me make some very practical applications as we go through this. To you married people out there, when you plan for the future, do you consider the well-being, the honour, and the feelings of your spouse? Or do you just think about yourself and your dreams? Employed people, do you put other people's jobs at risk in order to protect your own position? Students, do you lie to hide your bad behaviour and thereby get others into trouble? All of those are very common reactions in many places of life. Be real. Your faith can fail, as Abraham's did, and it can be shocking. Look at, fourthly, at the mess that unbelief can create, verses 17 to 20. But the Lord inflicted serious diseases on Pharaoh and his household because of Abraham's wife Sarah. So Pharaoh summoned Abraham. What have you done to me? He said. Why didn't you tell me she was your wife? Why did you say she is my sister so that I took her to be my wife? Now then, here is your wife. Take her and go. And then Pharaoh gave orders about Abraham to his men, and they sent him on his way with his wife and everything he had. I didn't read verse 16 deliberately, because when you read 16, it looks like Abraham's going to get off really good from this shocking behavior. It tells us that he was treated well for Sarah's sake. Pharaoh has taken her, as was expected, and added her to his harem. He treats Abraham well. Abraham acquires sheep and cattle, male and female donkeys, male and female servants and camels. Abraham prospered. This happens, you know, when we act in unbelief, not faith, to protect ourselves, and everything goes well, we can think, hey, good call, man. You did good there. Well done. Got away with that. Don't be fooled. Look at the mess that followed. Trouble for Pharaoh. God afflicted him. A tarnished witness, verses 18 to 20. And verse 20, our hero exits left, disgraced. What a tumble our hero has had. Is there any way back when you mess up like this in the life of faith? Do faith failures blow it with God? Well, no way, Jose, because the life of faith is grace from beginning to end. Look fifthly then at the fallen restored, verses 1 to 4 of chapter 13. So Abraham went up from Egypt to the Negev with his wife and everything he had, and Lot went with him. Abraham had become very wealthy in livestock and silver and gold. From the Negev he went from place to place until he came to Bethel, to the place between Bethel and Ai where his tent had been earlier, and where he had first built an altar. There Abraham called on the name of the Lord. Our story ends with Abraham returning to the promised land. That's our storyteller's way of telling us that he has repented and been restored with even more blessing than he had before. Now, I don't know if you noticed this as we read through the story, but in Egypt, no prayers, no altars, no witness, no self, just self-protection, a mess. Now, he prays and he builds an altar. Our hero is back walking the simple life of faith. It's as easy as that. Some people don't like the Christian faith because of teaching like this. They say, you mean you can just ignore God, do what you want, treat your wife shabby, mess up other people's lives, and then just say sorry and come back and God forgives it all? Yes. Yes, that's exactly what it means. But what about the innocent who are hurt by your actions? Did you notice in the story? God looked after Sarah. God looked after Pharaoh. You can trust God to clear up the mess that his people make. It doesn't excuse us. It doesn't mean we should just go off and sin left, right and center. But it does remind us that God's way is by grace from beginning to end. And when we come to our senses and repent, God forgives us and restores us and brings his blessing into our lives, which is such a tremendous encouragement and help to us. So let me just conclude. I'll use the language of the story. Have you been away in Egypt? Has your faith failed in the place of trial? Are you aware of debris all around you left in your wake? Well, don't wallow and don't hang around where you are. Come back. Come back. Come in prayer to the feet of Jesus and his sprinkled blood. Come to the altar. Return to the beginning, to the cross where grace and mercy meet. Let's just take a moment. Has God been speaking to you? I believe he has this morning. It's time to come back. Accept forgiveness. Trust him to help clear up the mess. I'm going to play a song for you to listen to. The words will come up as well, but you can just listen to this. As God calls us to come to the altar, to come back in simple repentance and faith, and to hear God say, "You're forgiven, you are restored." And if, as a result of listening to God this morning, you'd like help to talk to somebody, then just email me. That's pastor@freshbrook.org. And I'll organise something for you. Just listen to this song.
Are you hurting and broken within? Overwhelmed by the weight of your sin? Jesus is calling. Have you come to the end of yourself? Do you thirst for a drink from the well? Jesus is calling. Oh, come to the altar, the Father's altar.
Before we sing a song together and close our service, let me pray. Lord, we thank you for being in your presence today as we've watched this video. We thank you that scattered all over the place and watching at different times, yet your Holy Spirit unites us into the Lord Jesus Christ. And we pray that wherever we are on our journey of faith, this morning we will hear you say to us, "Follow me." We may just be setting out. We may have walked for a long time. We may, like Abraham, have found our faith has failed and be hearing you calling us back this morning. Wherever we are, help us to respond to you as you call us back. We thank you for the joy of singing your praise, of coming to you in prayer, of hearing your word, of sharing our stories. We thank you for the story of Abraham and how relevant it is to us today. Speak, we pray. In Jesus' name, help us to respond. Amen.
this together, even when I don't see it. Come on, even when.
Even when I don't see it, you're working. Even when I don't feel it, you're working. You never stop, you never stop working. You never stop, you never stop working.
Come on.
Even when I don't see it, you're working. Even when I don't feel it, you're working. You never stop, you never stop working. You never stop.
His name is above loneliness. Oh, his name is above disease. His name is above cancer. His name is above every other name. He says, that is who.
Amen.